Back on Rocky Top, Tennessee getting set to take on LSU here at Regal Soccer Stadium Thursday night, SEC Soccer. Brian Lee's team comes in at 9-5-1, 3-3-1 in SEC play, and their 4-4-2 formation. Alex Thomas expected to really be their star player.
Alex Thomas is extremely physical player. She's not afraid to take people on 1v1. Last year, she was named 2017 Coaches All-Region 13, 3 goals, 2 assists. And right now, Michael, she's on a 4-game streak. She scored in the last 4 games.
Tennessee on the other side, a 4-3-3 look for Coach Brian Penske's group, and defensively, 10 shutouts already this year.
Shay Yanez, man, she's just incredible between the pipes. She's big voice on the field, keeps that defense organized, and it's her 8 shutouts that have really make her stand out for this Tennessee team.
LSU's head man is Brian Lee in his 13th season with the Bayou Bengals. He 138 wins, 106 losses, 42 ties for Coach Lee and LSU. He's won 3 SEC West Division championships. That was in the latter portion of the 2000s. LSU in the white uniform tops, purple uniform bottoms. Tennessee on the other side with the pink uniform tops, the white lettering and numbering, and the white short bottoms. This is a big game. We highlighted it at the beginning. There's just 3 games left, and both of these teams with really tough schedules the rest of the way.
Anytime you're in the SEC conference, these last 3-4 matches, it's always pretty much like a boxing match. Who can get the extra points, the 3 points, the 1 points, the jockeying, as you mentioned in the opening. Teams are knocking each other left and right, and for good reason. The top 6 teams get a bye in the first round of the SEC. 10 teams qualify to move forward. As we highlighted, Tennessee's at 5. LSU's right there underneath Auburn. They're actually tied, and Auburn leads with an overall record. So this is a big-time game, and not just for SEC, but for RPI standings. LSU's 46 in the RPI, whereas Tennessee's at 14. So this would be a huge win for LSU for NCAAs.
LSU's final 3 matches against RPI teams, top 15 or better. South Carolina 9th, Mississippi State 10th, remaining on the schedule. We're ready for action here at Regal Soccer Stadium. LSU will get possession first, and it's been tough sledding on the road for LSU in the all-time series. 0-7-1 here in Knoxville. 18-6 has been the goal differential, so we'll see if LSU has something different here tonight on the road or if Tennessee continues its consistent play here at Regal Soccer Stadium. We're underway at LSU. Let's see how Tennessee defends here at the outset. Coach Brian Penske said that they have to do something a little bit differently on defense against this LSU group.
LSU has tremendous athletes, very skilled players that like to take on 1v1. They are very physical, so they're not afraid to match up 1v1 with Tennessee. For that reason, Tennessee has kind of switched back to that 4-3-3 formation. Just they feel like they're defending a little bit better and versus zonal defense on a 4-4-2.
Long throw is knotted. Yanez comes off. She bobbles it, and she picks it up. She's been fabulous this year for Tennessee, the senior from Downington, Pennsylvania. 10 shutouts this year as a group for the Vols. They had 10 all of last year.
And they're tied 2nd in the country with those 10 shutouts. They've only given up 7 goals in 14 games, 3 of which came against Vanderbilt. So this is a highly skilled, close-knit back line for Tennessee.
Talking to Coach Penske the other day, he mentioned that the back line, very consistent. That's been the group that he's been able to rely upon throughout this season.
And as a former defender, I can tell you, yes, you're closely, you got a great chemistry among your team, but there's something special about that back line. You have a personal pride about keeping teams from scoring goals against you.
Vignola evading a defender, plays a through ball. This is a great ball forward, touchback. Jordan, right-footed shot attempt, sails wide. But pretty good there from Tennessee, and Vignola running nearly the length of the pitch to pick out a teammate before Jordan took the shot.
And it's that run from the back from Vignola that gets things started for Tennessee. She finds Riley O'Keefe, who's making that breaking run across in between split of the defenders, who finds Solara Jordan.
LSU's goalkeeper is Caroline Brockmeyer, a Florida State transfer. Her freshman year, She was on a Florida State team that won a national championship, didn't play, was looking for a place to play, and landed here at LSU, and that's been just an absolute gem for Coach Lee's group.
You know, she's got 62 saves on the year, 240 all-time. She leads the country ninth. She's ninth in the country in terms of shutouts. And she really is the person who heads up that backline defense. They play very aggressive. You can see right now that their backline is stepped up. They're very offensive-minded. And that's because they have so much confidence in her ability in the back of the net.
Megan Flynn plays this ball long over the head of a racing Bialzak, and Vignola will get a throw for Tennessee. Vols wearing the pink jerseys, breast cancer awareness for the Vols here at Regal Soccer Stadium. Rally towels are the first 200 here today. Vignola throws one on the ground outside of the 18-yard box and gets it back. Spinning to her left-hand side, Flynn tries to keep it in play, and Vols will get a throw here as Flynn was taking it quickly. So Tennessee working this left sideline here early. Top of the 18-yard box. It's played back. Bialzak getting to her right-hand side. Has a teammate wide open on the far right sideline. Picking her out. Stopping, starting, getting towards the corner flag, and it'll be the first corner of the day for Tennessee.
And I like the work that Ren French is doing just to isolate the LSU defender on the outside. LSU defensively likes to stay pinched in tight. Tennessee really trying to opening up the passing channels there, resulting in a corner kick.
Katie Cousins will take the corner for Tennessee, a low liner that never came back into the field of play, and Tennessee concedes its first corner kick of the day. Fifth minute of action and no score between these two sides. For an LSU team here, they're extremely young. Six of their top eight scorers this year are underclassmen. A giveaway here in the back, picked up, going down in the box. But it is won cleanly and goes out for a corner. Nearly. Jordan had a phenomenal chance, but Lucy Parker just did get a piece here near the penalty spot. That left foot winning the ball out wide.
And that replay can show that that was a fairly contested tackle. You know, the first shot from behind, it looked questionable, but that replay shows that she did get a clean tackle, toe poking it away.
So now Cousins will take this corner from the opposite side. The in-swinger for Cousins near post, and another one given up by LSU.
And it's important to point out here, Michael, LSU, when it comes to set pieces and corner kicks, this is where they've given up many of their goals on the year, and this was something that Coach Lee pointed out that they had to be better at.
This ball towards the area, punched by Brockmeyer, and she picks it up, and she'll look to come the other way. Tennessee plenty of numbers back, and players sprinting in that direction. Richardson tries to go to the middle of the field. It's deflected and will go all the way back to Yanez for Tennessee.
And it's the quick release by Brockmeyer trying to catch Tennessee on their heels, that quick transition. How quickly can Tennessee shift back into shape? And as you can see, LSU was able to make it up the field pretty quickly.
Two of the more experienced keepers in the SEC this year. Racing after this one, Bialzak, but it'll go all the way back to Brockmeyer. Second on LSU's list in terms of shutouts. She has 22 in her career. Cousins will settle this one down. Tennessee three corner kicks early, but just one total shot here in the first half. Coming right to left come the Vols. Ball looking to the middle of the field. One touch, but Brockmeyer is there with Flynn hustling towards the area. So Tennessee starting to look pretty dangerous here, but Brockmeyer cleaning things up.
And Tennessee's doing a really good job trying to pull the LSU's defense wide, making those passing channels so that Flynn can make those breaking runs. And when we say breaking runs, we're talking about those diagonal runs splitting the two defenders.
Top of the 18-yard box with a left-footed shot low. Yanez is there to pick it up as Thomas was taking that left-footed shot for LSU. So a lot of activities inside the 18-yard box here early. Eighth minute of play. This ball slips under an LSU defender's foot, but promptly picked back up and will go back left to right. Right between the circles, it'll go back to the senior keeper for Tennessee. Cousins comes out for Vignola. Vignola looking for, picking out Jordan, making a run, and her touch lets her down. And LSU will get the throw.
Where I think Tennessee is most successful is when they play sideline to sideline, when they really take advantage of the width of the field. And you can see Vignola trying to get forward, really utilizing the space on the outside. Then you have Tennessee's forwards running across the top, which creates space on the backside. So how quickly can Tennessee move that ball around? They're going to have to swing it fast if they want to catch the LSU Tigers on their heels.
LSU's won back-to-back matches. Tennessee, a loss and a tie in its last two. Tennessee hasn't gone three straight matches without a win since the last four games of the 2015 season. So trying to get back in the win column on its home field.
And Michael, you mentioned that LSU hasn't really had much success on the road. However, Coach Lee noted to us in the pregame that this is a team that's really come on in the last half of the season, and especially as we're here moving forward, you can see there they've outscored their opponents 31-5, winless in eight straight SEC road matches. Last winning SEC road season was in 2012. So this is a team that struggled on the road, but tonight they're playing with some enthusiasm and a lot of fire because they want to qualify for that tournament.
Coach Lee said that this was their next big test to firmly implant themselves on the uptick, was going on the road and coming out with a positive result. And we'll see if they can get it here against Tennessee. 10th minute of play. LSU picking up the ball with Newton, but given right back for Cousins. Tennessee phenomenal here at home over the years. Always been a tough place for opponents to come, and a fairly nice crowd here. Earlier today, fantastic weather, right in the 60s, but temperatures dipping as we get through the rest of the evening. Tennessee again building, but this pass eludes a pair of players in pink for Tennessee. But a giveaway, one touch towards the left-hand side of the 18-yard box. And now LSU with an opportunity to counter the other way. Alexander with the ball, sprinting to the middle of the field. Flynn on her back, but Alexander with more pace. A lot of dribbling here. Alexander gets to the top of the 18-yard box. A flick on, and a shot is into the back of the net as Thomas strikes first for LSU here in the 10th minute.
This LSU Tiger team is extremely athletic, and it's Tanea Alexander from the back who comes up the field screaming, able to find Thomas with that little slip pass as Yanez comes out for it. And LSU posts up the goal first.
I mean, that is a run from pretty much LSU entire opportunity to counter the other way. Alexander yard box sprinting to the middle to the other side of the field, and nobody for Tennessee stepped up. And what a great run, though, by Thomas.
And I think there's a real big missed opportunity defensively. You see Katie Cousins trailing. That would have been a great chance for her to kind of make that diagonal run, cut her off at the very least, continue to push her to the outside. But instead, she runs straight up the gut, completely uncontested, with Megan Heels, a forward, on her heels. Not one person stepped up to her.
What's interesting, too, is Coach Lee was talking about that this team sometimes gets a little too obsessed with making those long dribbling runs, and sometimes it affects what they're able to do, but it works perfectly for the first goal of the night.
Richardson and Alexander had lots of combinations plays against Ole Miss. They took on Ole Miss, beat them 3-1 the other night. Very talented, and it seems as if they, as the minutes go on, as long as they have that lead, they continue to just bring the energy to the field.
Thomas gets it for Tennessee. Vols trying to counter back after conceding a goal moments ago. To the top of the box. Pretty good run here, and a right-footed shot takes a deflection and goes out of play, and Tennessee will get its fourth corner of the day as Gilroy was making that run.
And this is where Tennessee really misses having Bunny's presence. She's such a target for them when it comes to corner kicks, set pieces. At 5'11", they're able to find her head often. So not having her on the pitch right now is definitely an effect for Tennessee.
Riley O'Keefe will take this corner for Tennessee. Swings it outward. Bialzak gets a header to it, but it goes over the trees behind the net and out of play. 1-0 LSU with a lead. This was a much better effort from Tennessee on a corner.
And just the timing of the run when she makes contact with the ball is a little bit off.
Cousins for Tennessee taking possession back. She picks out a running Flynn, but good bit of defending right in the middle of the field. Keeps it off of the feet of that run. Now here comes LSU sprinting the other way. Parker has it. She was the one that originally intercepted it. Switches fields right to left. Top of the 18-yard box. Defending is French. This ball takes a ricochet, and then Cousins sends it out wide past French. And the Vols will get a throw.
What's leading LSU to the success is their ability on the quick counterattacks. As we've seen, their defenders are running up quickly. They're looking to find those forwards breaking across, and they're changing the point of attack faster than Tennessee can recover. If Tennessee wants to hang in this game, they're going to have to make sure defensively that they are getting back faster. Their recovery runs and their positioning on defense is a bit more intact.
Neal gets it out wide for Vignola. This is where Tennessee was able to make a good build-up earlier, but a giveaway as Bialzak couldn't quite stop that ball. Petrie to the middle of the field, and Tutura. Flynn goes back for Neal. Neal back for Flynn. 14th minute of play. LSU struck in the 10th minute as Tennessee gives this ball away. Vignola trying to win possession back. Good job using her body, and it goes out for a goal kick.
It's Tennessee's first touch and little careless passes that's really hurting them at the moment. You see Megan Flynn with a missed pass there, gobbled up by the LSU Tigers. Tennessee's going to have to clean up that first and second touch if they want to keep possession.
Last nine meetings have been fairly tight between these two groups. Five of those nine have gone to overtime. Tennessee's record 3-3-3, and that includes a win in the SEC tournament in PKs. So you definitely do get the feel that a 1-0 tally is not going to be the final in this one. Middle of the field, Vols trying to settle it down, but unable to hold on to possession. Petrie again with it. Sends it back for Alexander. Alexander mishits this ball and gives it away to the Vols. Flynn, one touch, couldn't evade a defender. Another good bit of defending. Lucy Parker was the one that stopped that ball.
And again, Riley O'Keefe had time. There's no need to rush that pass. Is a good look. She's looking for that run by Slayer Jordan to split the defenders. However, O'Keefe had time. If she held it just a little bit longer.
Another opportunity here for LSU. Neal coming out, and a good play to get a piece of that ball, but Tennessee not done defending yet. Really good job by Neal. That looked like that had the makings of something for LSU. Cross into the box. Not cleared cleanly by the Vols, and LSU continues with this pressure here early. Vols able to get it back, stepping to it. Here's Jordan. Let's see if Tennessee can get something going in the other direction. A long run here for Bialzak, trying to use that pace to win the ball, and she's able to do so. Excellent effort for Bialzak. Plays it to the top of the box, however, and takes one skip. And LSU will come back the other way, left to right. Newton with it. Now it comes forward for Alex Thomas. Her fourth goal of the year, made it 1-0. 1v1 here with a dribble. Cousins coming over the top, and at this time, Cousins was much better defensively winning that ball.
And that's what she needs to do, especially in this 4-4-3. They have her as that defensive midfielder for that reason, to be the last player in the center before it gets to the center backs, to try to slow down play, allowing Gunnar and Maya Neal to make sure they're in good position for cover.
See, we'll start from the back here. So the Vols have had 10 shutouts this season. But early on in this one, LSU with the goal. Long run down the far right sideline. Vols with something here. getting into the six-yard area. Ball cut back across. One touch. And a shot hits the chest. Now a left-footed attempt. Takes a redirection. What an effort by Brockmeyer to get a piece of it and send it out of play after Flynn's chance.
And it all starts with Aaron Gilroy down the sides, drives it in lines, commits the goalkeeper and the defender to the near post. The ball's on the backside. Megan Flynn with another opportunity and an almost own goal by Lucy Parker. But Brockmeyer able to come up with a big save.
Fifth corner already for Tennessee. This one's short, and the Vols haven't done a whole lot with these corner kick opportunities. They've only linked up with a teammate just one time through five corners. Neal will send this long ball looking for Jordan. She read it properly as Parker got ahead to it, but it goes out of play. And another corner kick for Tennessee.
Tennessee with six corner kicks. You'd like to see Tennessee to be able to finish one of these. And in fact, I think they're going to need to going forward if they want to get on the board.
Yeah, find a way to get one of these set pieces to force some action. Cousins back on a short corner this time. Vignola takes it, getting bumped off the ball. And will have to retreat all the way back near the ribbon. As now she swings one in to the back post. Racing after it was French, but it goes out of play. And the Vols again unable to cash in on a corner kick opportunity.
And here's an interesting stat. When LSU takes the lead going into the locker room after the first 45 minutes play, they are 7-2 for 2018. So that just tells you, you know, when they get up and they stay up before half, they typically are able to close out the game.
Yeah, 13 of their 23 goals this year have come in the first half. Racing after this one, Jordan. She's putting in a lot of effort, but covering a lot of ground. Jordan picks out Gilroy. And LSU again stymieing a rush for the Vols here in the 19th minute. LSU trying to switch fields. This ball has been on this half of the field for quite a while. Comes out wide. Alexander, she made a long run. That set up Thomas for the game's lone goal. Vignola got a piece of that ball. And then it's played out of play in Tennessee.
And that's much more pressure cover. That's what we're used to seeing from Tennessee. First player slows down the ball. Second player, the cover person's in a position to be able to step in and read the play, winning the ball.
Neal will go back to Shea Yanez. She comes into the middle for Katie Cousins. Bialzak gets a touch and sends it out wide. Tennessee fifth in the SEC. LSU is sixth. Three games to go in the regular season. This ball coming forward looking for Flynn to make the run, but Parker's there to step to it defensively. And Tennessee does a much better job of stopping this run from one of the defenders of LSU. Ball's not done yet. Bialzak uses the left foot. Good ball. Racing after it is Jordan, trying to get there before it goes across the chalk and unable to do so. And a goal kick here for LSU. Sunday, it's a top 20 showdown in the SEC at 5 Eastern. It's number 18 Tennessee visiting College Station to take on number 5 Texas A&M. It's SEC soccer on the SEC Network. Games also streaming live on the ESPN app. That's a big one for Tennessee. They are 1-21 all-time against top five teams. That one win came back in 2003, so this is a big one for the Vols before they get a big challenge on Sunday. 21st minute, 1-0, LSU with the lead thanks to a goal from Thomas set up by Alexander. Balls have had six corners and four shots, but none on frame thus far. Two shots on frame for LSU. Shea Yanez has it in the back. And if you're Tennessee, you're roughly halfway through this first half. LSU has a couple subs. Does Coach Penske change anything up with his lineup here shortly?
I think without question, you'll see the Tennessee coaching staff add some new flavor to the pitch. I mean, they've had a lot of success with different players. Marcano, quick, fast up top. I'm sure we'll look to see her. I wouldn't be surprised if you see Bunny come in for a few minutes. I mean, they've got a lot of depth, and I think they're going to need to in order to keep throwing different looks, different surprises at LSU.
13 different players have scored for Tennessee this year, and Coach Penske likes that, thinks that there's a lot of players that can score, but Bunny Shaw, obviously, just a complete difference maker for Tennessee, and he mentioned that the committee did not score against Georgia, but they have been good in other games without Bunny Shaw this year. Jordan inside the circle, gives it back for Bialzak. Left-footed ball comes out wide. Tennessee using this left sideline yet again. Flynn playing through for O'Keefe. O'Keefe flings it over the head of Ignola. Jordan tries to touch it, but Parker and company again with the defense as this ball takes a skip. Good hustle by O'Keefe. And now Alexander turning out towards the sideline and just trying to clear it forward. Neal stepping to it, heading it down the sideline, but it goes out of play.
And Tennessee, at the moment, they look like they're playing a little bit direct for me. As I mentioned, I like when they move the ball more from sideline to sideline. I think they're going to have to get a little bit more creative in where they're creating those passing channels. We're seeing a lot of balls slip through and in behind the defense, but it's right through the center. I think they're going to have to come on the outside and look for those quick combinations, changing the point of attack.
Danielle Marcano, right on cue, does come into the match for Tennessee, replacing Jordan in the lineup right up top. Marcano, the intended target on this pass.
And I like that choice by the Tennessee coaching staff. Marcano is fast, but she's also one of those players who isn't afraid to let her physical presence be known. And against these athletes for LSU, I think that's going to be a great matchup.
Marcano, a senior from Buford, Georgia, 3 goals, 3 assists this year. Mostly coming off of the bench for Tennessee. 24th minute, 1-0 LSU trying to win a contest over a ranked team here on the road in SEC play. Bayou Bengals have lost 8 straight SEC road games since a victory almost 2 years ago today at Mississippi State. 1-0 win in that one. Alexander, who had a lengthy run earlier, sends this ball forward. Looks like Tennessee's defense being a little more aggressive, but Gunner gives way now, and here comes LSU with a seeking shot attempt that goes wide for a goal kick. So Tennessee getting Bunny Shaw back for the remainder of the season, and I mean, history last night. Just a phenomenal game, and Bunny Shaw was as good as it gets in the world. 19 goals, leading all players internationally with those goals.
And I really like what our tombstone says there, Jamaican history. I mean, it's the first time that this Jamaican women's national team has ever qualified for the Women's World Cup. And what's even, you know, another one is against Panama. Panama was also another team that was looking to get in. So, you know, to be a part of a history-making scenario is incredible for Bunny. She's not a selfish player, and I can guarantee you that it's just eating at her that she's not on the field for Tennessee at the moment.
Gilroy trying to go to the top of the box. It is Bialzak that gets a touch, slips past a couple defenders, but people crashing on her. Marcano goes down. Ball won by LSU. But Tennessee continues to apply the pressure. Coming out wide, and here comes Alexander. We saw a run just like this. Let's see if the Vols shut this run down. Similar spot, Flynn having to chase her. From the back, Alexander, this time Neal steps up and takes possession. That was eerily similar to the goal earlier.
And thank goodness Neal was there to stop that play. Again, you've got Katie Cousins making that recovery run. She has no player around her, so I'm not quite sure why she's not trying to do some duties there and trying to push LSU to the outside. Instead, you've got Mackenzie Gunner, who's a front runner, making that run all the way back.
Tennessee coming back again. They have numbers in the box. Right-footed shot. Brockmeyer slides down and picks it up as Gilroy took aim at frame. So Tennessee getting some opportunities here. Really both sides are, but Vols haven't been able to solve the mystery of Brockmeyer early. Ball is pilfered by Richardson. Richardson, another Florida State transfer, just like Brockmeyer. Tennessee with Bielzak. But back to Bunny Shaw, I mean, you can't step anything outside of just saying that what she was able to accomplish and that country was able to accomplish was phenomenal. She played 45 minutes against the U.S. on Sunday and really held her own and showed that she still has a lot of untapped potential left.
And in the game against Panama, she scored the first goal in the 13th minute to put her team up. She just has that kind of presence about her. She's a fierce competitor, and I guarantee you, once she takes the pitch tonight, she's one of those players that not only elevates the play of her teammates, but of everybody on the field. And the Tennessee coaching staff likes to describe her sometimes as a woman among girls. She just has that it factor about her, the composure, just the heads-up soccer smarts about her. And sportsmanship. She's a great sportsman. She's not a dirty player. Very relaxed, fun-loving. She's a joy to be around.
Coach Penske compared her to Abby Wambach, who you played against when you were playing. So you know a little bit what it's like to have one of the more dominant physical players in the world, and you have to challenge her.
And Abby Wambach, she was phenomenal, and there is a lot of similarities between the two of them. They're both very tall. I mean, 5'11", that's, you know, when you're 5'6", 5'7", those inches make a lot of difference, especially when we're contending for balls in the air. But just the composure and the ability to know where to position your body, and that's the kind of smarts that both of those two players have and what makes them so tough to defend.
So Bunny Shaw said that she's good to go tonight. Don't expect to see her for a lot of action, but certainly Brian Penske has an extra weapon at his disposal. Marcano with a touch here. Not a lot of numbers. Actually, no real numbers for her. She's trying to hold it up and wait for reinforcements. Bielzak has the pass slip behind her. And Tennessee unable to link up yet again, and LSU with an opportunity to come back the other way.
And here's another quick counterattack. Megan Flynn able to slow them down a little bit. LSU's most effective defensively, they're staying really tight on that back line. They know Tennessee wants to slot those balls. They're giving up space on the outside, so I think Tennessee's going to have to draw them out a little bit and then try to play those balls in and across or drive it in line and slide it back across the top of the six in order to create those channels that are going to bring goal-scoring opportunities.
It was a 10th-minute goal by Thomas that has made it 1-0, and that's where we stand now. Here in the 30th minute, ball coming forward for Marcano, trying to race after it towards the corner flag, and by doing so, she wins her team a throw, and now the pink jerseys can mosey in that direction.
And LSU's done their homework on Tennessee. I mean, the pace at which this game is being played at is very high tempo. I mean, Tennessee usually goes high tempo for the first few minutes, and then they try to do their best to take control and slow it down. And at the moment, if you were to ask me, I think LSU's done a really good job of controlling the tempo and keeping it at that high pace.
Another throw in for the Vols. Tennessee, 5 shots just like LSU. The difference is that Thomas strikes sliding near the left-hand side of the 6-yard box. Ball's deep in that corner. This ball low cross. Marcano got a touch. Gets taken down in the box. Official puts his hands to his side. Says nothing illegal there. And LSU with a chance to come back the other way. Good hold up. And kept alive by LSU to maintain possession here. Alexander comes to the right-hand side.
LSU's doing a really good job of using the complete width of the field, changing it from the right side to the left side, trying to work it inside Tennessee's 18.
We were talking about international duty with Bunny Shaw. Well, Coach Penske has been in that spot several times before. Katie Cousins missed the entirety of the 2016 season with international duty. And he said it's a double-edged sword. He feels bad for the seniors because that's their last chance to battle for championships. But at the same time, he said he would not give away any of those minutes that he does get from those players. Inside the 18-yard box, good bit of defending by French. Able to win possession back and then just clears it out for a throw-in.
And that's great composure by French, not stabbing, being patient, really standing Thomas up, waiting for that moment to step in and win the ball. And to your point, Michael, absolutely. Anytime you recruit an international player, you know, as a coaching staff and as a team, it's tough because, as you mentioned, you know, players are gone for huge chunks of the season. But at the same time, it's that experience and just that level of play when they come back to your team. It's incredible to be able to share that with your team and to be able to support your teammates as they're representing their country. But it is tough on the team because typically those players are standouts, leaders. And so trying to fill in the holes can sometimes be challenging and a lot of times a tall order to fill.
Yeah, it's not like you're going to have three or four of those players at your disposal. But it is interesting. College soccer with that international duty, a lot of the pro leagues do take that time off for those duties. And one of the few college sports in which you actually have to deal with that.
Well, and I think this Tennessee program has gotten a lot better at balancing their talent. You know, we had Hannah Wilkinson a few years ago, and she represented New Zealand, so she missed a lot of time. And then you had Katie Cousins, and now you have Bunny Shaw. And the difference is each year that they've had a player step out, the goal scoring is being better distributed among the team. So I think you're seeing a real growth in the talent and the depth of this Tennessee program.
See if the Vols can get one here before the break, or maybe LSU might have a second in mind on their side after scoring in the 10th minute. Near sideline, LSU trying to work down this right side as it goes out of play. Eaton trying to get possession, the sophomore. But Tennessee will take the throw. Now Cousins coming back right to left.
And Michael, it's interesting because I think that this is probably one of the first Tennessee games that we've broadcast where we haven't seen more subs go in. And so, you know, to this point, Tennessee's only had one substitution in.
O'Keefe looked like she had some space, but that was shut down by Lucy Parker. LSU's back four has done a really good job, not only of defending, but starting some of these breaks for their side.
It's the quick counterattacks and pulling the Tennessee midfielders over to the outside, which is creating those passing channels. And LSU's doing a tremendous job. You've got Eaton, and when Thomas was in, Richardson, they're making those breaking runs across the back line, and not vertically, but horizontally, so across the field. And those are tough to defend.
What a run here by Vignola, trying to do what her opposition did earlier. Vignola gets bumped off the ball and will go for a goal kick. Kicking us off at noon on Saturday, it's Tulsa and Arkansas. At 4, it's Memphis taking on Missouri from Columbia. Then at 7:30, number 14 Kentucky welcomes Vanderbilt to Nashville in our SEC Saturday night matchup presented by Holiday Inn Express. No one covers the SEC like we do. Also stream it live on the ESPN app. Foul whistled, and Tennessee will get a free kick inside of its half of the pitch. Also have had some chances, 6 corner kicks, but haven't been able to force a whole lot of defending. Coach Lee talked about that his team's got to get tougher inside the box. And so far, they've been able to do so. Gunnar hits it. Marcano is trying to get a piece of it. Instead, LSU again winning possession and looking to head back the other way.
You know, LSU did a tremendous job of containing the Ole Miss Rebels last Thursday night. CC Kaiser, one of the leading scorers for the SEC, wasn't even really present on the field. I mean, they were able to contain her. And you see LSU able to do the same thing with Tennessee. Tennessee's got a lot of talent. And so far, we really haven't seen much from their front runners.
Final 9 minutes here of the first half. Tennessee looking for a response to a 10th-minute goal by Alex Thomas. These two teams jockeying for position. Tennessee entered 5th in the SEC, LSU 6th. And challenging schedules remain for each of these two schools.
And tremendous play by Lucy Parker, just taking control of the back, keeping possession, making some great runs, movement off the ball. She was noted as one of the SEC defending players of the week earlier this season, and rightfully so.
Parker, part of that international flair of this group. She's a sophomore. Her sister, Holly, is a senior on the track and field team. And Lucy Parker playing for Arsenal's youth program, and that's kind of opened a door for Coach Lee's recruiting process. Tennessee gets a throw along this sideline.
And you can see when Tennessee's mounting their attack, it's much slower than LSU.
Another corner kick opportunity.
LSU getting a little aggressive on the back. There's been two shoulder charges. I'm surprised that last one wasn't called for a penalty.
So now here comes Bunny Shaw into the match for Tennessee. 24 hours ago, probably right around this exact moment, she was celebrating with Jamaica, reaching the World Cup for the first time in its country's history. Now she's here in Knoxville. Ball flings into the middle. Vignola has it evade her, and now it comes out towards midfield. So Coach Penske using Shaw. Shaw running after this one towards the penalty spot. Instead, it'll be a right-footed attempt by Gilroy.
Clearly, you can state the urgency by this Tennessee coaching staff. 7 minutes to go. They definitely want to slide into the locker room, tied up, if not with a lead.
Bunny Shaw and the Reggae Girls, as they're referred to, for Jamaica, getting into the World Cup with a 4-2 win in PKs last night against Panama. 1-0 LSU here, however. Tigers trying to get into the break with this lead. Ball ping-ponging around here near midfield. The Vols will fling it forward, but slipping to the ground before regaining possession. Shaw has two defenders on her. Let's see if Gilroy makes something happen. Gilroy to the top of the box. Right-footed attempt. Slices wide. Mentioned Lucy Parker earlier. You see Holly Parker there. She's a mid-distance runner at LSU. And her coming to LSU kind of started things working for the Bayou Bengals soccer program, as Lucy came here, and she's one of four players from that Arsenal youth program that is on this LSU team. Ball chipped out wide by Shaw. Tennessee trying to build things up from the right-hand side as it goes out of play for a corner kick. And Coach Brian Lee talked about the other day that it's a testament to Lucy Parker and the rest of that group that you get one player that has a positive experience, and now everybody seems to want to come to LSU, and has certainly helped this group. There you see the players. Three of those were on the pitch to start the night for LSU. This one comes in. Shaw, the intended target. It just misses her head. Now Vignola takes a shot. Goes over the crossbar. Tennessee with much better effort there on that corner.
Talking about leadership, Mary Alice Vignola, she's such a force to be reckoned with. Coming out of the back, she's a tough defender, but she's even tougher on offense. Her speed and athletic ability and that left-footed shot, just a zinger.
Shaw heads this one along. Now it comes out towards this sideline. Tennessee trying to get something going here in the final 4.5 minutes of the first half, trailing at 1-0. They've never lost to LSU here in Knoxville in the all-time series. 7-0-1. And Alex Thomas goal in the 10th minute is the difference here in the first half. Neal comes out wide for Ren French. French charging forward right to left. Slips it forward for Vignola. Vignola picks out Shaw. Shaw tracks back to get it and chips it along towards that right sideline. Tennessee building things up from the right side. Gilroy sends it in. Shaw was trying to wait for it, but Lucy Parker, very decisive, step to it. Vignola heads this along towards the sideline, angling towards the corner flag. Doesn't have the momentum to go out of play. Vignola trying to win it. Instead, it'll be a throw in here for LSU.
That's a smart play by Tanea Alexander, recognizing that M.A. Vignola on her back, just a quick little heel flick off of Tennessee. LSU throw in, able to keep possession. And again, we talk about managing the clock and the tempo. 3 minutes to go in the game. LSU's doing an outstanding job in maintaining the tempo, controlling the game. Really haven't allowed Tennessee to get in any kind of rhythm whatsoever.
Saturday at 10 a.m. Eastern, 9 Central, SEC Nation will be in Knoxville, Tennessee for Tennessee and number one, Alabama. Laura, Marcus, Paul, Tim, and Lauren break down everything from the gridiron to the grill. SEC Nation presented by Johnsonville right here on the SEC Network. Also stream it live on the ESPN app. Final 2.5 minutes of the first half. LSU 7-2 in leading at the break this year. Do the Vols have an answer here in this final moments? They've had the pressure. Cousins takes possession. Cousins getting it to her left foot. Now over to Vignola. Vignola trying to get into the box, and Alexander pushes it out of play.
And I like the urgency that Tennessee is putting on LSU, pressing everybody forward. However, Michael, we should point out, at the moment, Tennessee is only holding two defenders back. So if LSU has a quick transition, it could be troublesome for Tennessee.
This ball goes out of play, and it'll be a corner kick. So Tennessee gets another one. They've had so many corners. This is the ninth one of a half.
Well, I can tell you one thing. If I'm Coach Penske, I can guarantee you that this is an element of our game that we would be working on before we take on our next opponent.
Cousins hits this in swinger to the middle of the post. One header wide open was French after one piece came to her, but she hit it over the top of the crossbar with an empty net in front of her.
And that's probably the closest attempt that Tennessee has had all night in regards to corner kicks. Great placement by Katie Cousins. Great flick by Brockmeyer. That touch that Brockmeyer had is actually the reason why Tennessee wasn't able to put that in the back of the net.
Gilroy was the target initially, but yeah, Brockmeyer got that right hand to it. And now LSU with a break coming this way, Eaton with the ball. Numbers to her right-hand side. She picks out a right-footed shot from Richardson that hits the outside of the cage.
And Tennessee coming up lucky defensively there. LSU's so quick on the transitions, and Tennessee's getting caught in a numbers-down situation. You can see here two players advancing forward. There's the third one in the picture, and it's a 3v2 situation, really with Maya Neal the only one back.
She tried to tuck it in that short side of the net, but unable to do so. Half minute to go here in the first half. And a quick throw, and Tennessee gives away possession. So they use this 10 minutes of Bunny Shaw in the first half. And for right now, it doesn't seem like they're going to get anything after a misplay. Brockmeyer will grab it. Shaw will make her pick it up. And that is basically how this first half will come to a close. Brockmeyer won't need to do anything with it. And we've played 45 minutes, and if you're Tennessee, you wish that you were able to capitalize on some of your opportunities.
Absolutely, and where Tennessee is getting hammered is on the quick transitions. They're going to have to be faster defensively recovering. In order to score against LSU, yes, you're going to have to get numbers up, but your recovery on defense is going to have to be even faster, and you're going to have to mark up tighter on those front runners. LSU's movement off of their forward line is absolutely phenomenal. They're moving quick. They're explosive as they're attacking the goal, and that's the difference maker in tonight's matchup.
A 10th-minute goal from Alex Thomas has LSU on top as they look to snap a string of 8 straight games without a win on the road in SEC play. Halftime, it's 1-0, LSU on top of Tennessee. Tennessee, you see that second-to-last line there on the right-hand side. 9 corner kicks in the first half, and that was something that it seemed like Coach Brian Lee was looking to see if they could handle things today, but they've done a great job handling Tennessee's corners.
Well, this is something that LSU has really put an emphasis to improve upon. They've given up a lot of goals on set piece and corner kicks, and tonight they've done a tremendous job defending against Tennessee.
So let's see what Tennessee is able to do here in the second half. Trailing it 1-0. They've never lost to LSU here at home. LSU, however, 7-2 this year when they lead at halftime. Brockmeyer's been very good in goal, but only needed to make one save. She did have a deflection on a corner that kept the ball off of Gilroy's head.
Tennessee's got to get right down to business if they plan on hanging in with this LSU Tigers team. They have a tendency sometimes to kind of wait, sit back. They've got to come out flying out of the gates right from the start. They've got 44 minutes left in this game to try to flip it.
Vols bring Bunny Shaw onto the pitch to start the second half. We don't expect to see her very long in this second half as she's tracking down this ball that Brockmeyer hits it. She just played 110 minutes last night for Jamaica. She gets a touch, spinning to her right-hand side, using that physicality to maintain possession. Gets to her left foot, puts a shot on that Brockmeyer will have to scoop up on a ball that skipped across the grass.
And I think that's a smart play from the Tennessee coaching staff. Putting Bunny on the field is going to draw LSU defenders to her. She's too talented to leave her on her own, so you're going to have one or two defenders. And if you mark up Bunny, that's creating space and an open player for another Tennessee person.
I think another thing that it does, too, it takes the pressure off of her. Rather than put her in the final 10 minutes, if you're still down 1-0, there's no pressure now. You still have plenty of game left for Tennessee to get one goal.
And, Michael, if she doesn't make contact anywhere else on the field except for with her head or her foot on a corner kick, it's a win for Tennessee. LSU's been giving the ball up on the inline, so if Tennessee can capitalize on one of the corner kicks, then it's going to be successful.
Shaw holding this ball up, at least momentarily, before giving way to LSU. Shots were 9-6, or 8-6 rather, Tennessee in the first half, now at 9-6 after Shaw's opportunity. Bialzak takes it, and here comes the Vols left to right. Bialzak settling down now, trying to get past Alexander before Alexander hits it out wide. It'll go for a throw in here for Tennessee.
And this is key. Tennessee has to try to control the tempo. I think LSU has done an outstanding job of taking control of the game. And by having Alexander come all the way back on defense, you know, that's one less player that LSU has in the attack. So I think Tennessee has to look to continue to push numbers forward and really try to control the tempo.
LSU winless in 8 straight SEC road games, 0-6-2 in that span, being outscored 19-4. Trying to get a win on the road against a conference foe for the first time since 2016. But they've led since the 10th-minute goal from Thomas. Burdett plays it backwards and gets it back, but it hits the back of her shoe and taken by Chutura before it goes back to Yanez. Tennessee, we talked about their defense and how good they had been, 10 shutouts this year. How have they reacted since that opening goal for LSU?
Well, we saw the Tennessee coaching staff speaking with Gunnar and Maya Neal, the two center backs. They're thought to kind of be, you know, the glue that keeps that back together. And, you know, we've seen them struggle tonight in terms of stepping up and slowing down LSU's front runners. And I think a good part of that is they're afraid if they step, there's going to be that breaking run behind them. But that's where Tennessee's just got to be tighter on your marks on the outside. And I think that's part of the reason why Tennessee made that substitution with Burdett.
Great ball by Bialzak. And how about this? A penalty conceded by Parker. Really in a spot she had no business going to her feet.
And, you know, LSU gave up a PK against Ole Miss, and I think this is the right call. You had Bialzak inside the box, under her feet, and that's just an unnecessary tackle right there. You can see that she's really trying to get the ball. Unfortunately, the ball's out of play when she makes that tackle. So tough break for Lucy Parker, but this is great for Tennessee.
She got a lot of the ball, but more of Bialzak. Shaw was not one of the PK takers last night for Jamaica, but she'll take this one for Tennessee. She steps forward, puts it on, it hits the pipe, rolls to the left-hand side. I think Brockmeyer got a piece of it. And she keeps Shaw out of the scoring column here.
And it's easy to see why Brockmeyer is one of the top in the country when it comes to shutouts. She had a huge save against Ole Miss. CeCe Kaiser took a PK, which Brockmeyer saved. And again tonight, coming up big for LSU.
I think she just got it. She guessed right. She was leaning in that direction the entire way. Shaw elevated maybe a few inches too high. And Shaw denied her eighth goal of the year and now her eighth game.
And this is just a really unfortunate hit right here. You see Bunny, and then, yes, Brockmeyer gets enough, just enough of a touch on it to make sure that it hits the post. Right there it is, and unlucky. Unlucky for Tennessee, but huge for Brockmeyer and this LSU Tiger team.
Well, as we were talking about, you put Shaw on the pitch here to start the second half, and things work exactly how you would have liked them to. Making this run here is Richardson, if she's able to link up to the ball after Neal. Richardson takes a right-footed shot on. Yanez punches it down. Nobody in white running after the ball, and Yanez is able to pick it up cleanly.
And again, it's the quick counterattack from LSU. Just able to attack out of that right flank. They love getting the ball to Tanaya Alexander, putting it all the way across, finding Richardson completely unmarked. Richardson taking it right at Tennessee's two center backs who don't step.
Vignola will come out wide here for Gilroy. Things are pretty open right now. Tennessee getting into the box as Gilroy plays it into the middle. Taken down momentarily, and then O'Keefe can't get one on frame. Cousins now will take a seeking opportunity to actually hit Shaw. Shaw spins with a left-footed shot. That's deflected back to her. Then Shaw takes another chance, but a foul is whistled prior to that.
The number of LSU white jerseys inside the 18 is just incredible. I mean, the opportunities right in front of the box are not going to be there for Tennessee. Tennessee has to do a better job of getting their head up and really working it in from the outside. In addition, the inside the six shots aren't going to be there. Tennessee has to find Katie Cousins on top or Anna Bialzak. That ball played across on top of the 18 to keep this LSU Tigers defense honest.
Tennessee providing pressure here in the opening moments, taking several shots, requiring several saves from Brockmeyer. But right now, still 1-0 LSU, 7 minutes gone by in the second half. Brockmeyer picking it up. I mentioned earlier that she was a part of the national championship team at Florida State, did not play that year, and Coach Lee acknowledged that her first season playing for LSU, she had to get her playing game back underneath her. And she has been excellent for LSU, second on the program's all-time shutouts list, 22 of them. She's eight behind the all-time leader. Tennessee trying to challenge her yet again. This one crossed over everybody's head and will go out of play on this sideline.
And Michael, you know, in pregame we saw Brockmeyer on the field and she is so tall and intimidating. 22 shutouts, ranked second in the country, 243 saves, 24 wins. She's tied for third. She's a huge leader for this LSU team and much of the reason why they are where they are tonight. Making a big save like that on the PK, being able to command her defense, making sure people in the right position. You can see that communication and how key it is to that back line.
This ball comes in. Brockmeyer actually has to get a piece of it. It was getting close to the pipe. And she clears it away.
And just the confidence that she exudes back there.
Brockmeyer's seen a lot of time in net for Coach Brian Lee. And her PK save on Bunny Shaw's opportunity is the reason why LSU still maintains this lead.
And this is a big win for LSU, should they be able to close it out.
Shaw making a run, 1v2. She stops. She has Bialzak open. Bialzak, left-footed chance is blocked. going across the end line, hustling back to make that save was Parker, making amends for giving up a PK earlier.
And this is why having Bunny in the game is so instrumental. You can see she just cuts it back to the right, drawing two defenders with her from LSU, finding Bielsack wide open. It's that recovery run from LSU's Lucy Parker, able to help come up with the save, keeping Tennessee off the board.
Well, you feel like right now that Tennessee is moments away from breaking through. Cousins will serve up the 10th corner of this night. Sends it in low. Shaw the target, and I don't think it made a whole lot of contact, if any, of her head. It comes all the way out towards this sideline. Another cross coming in over Shaw's head. It'll be tamed by O'Keefe. Now comes out to the middle of the field. Right-footed flick, Shaw the target. A lot of defending being needed here for LSU as Tennessee continues to apply pressure.
This is a great, wonderful look by Katie Cousins. I was just thinking in my head, golly, VA's wide open and able to find Vignola on the outside. So, again, Tennessee's got to work it in from the outside in.
These two teams came in fifth and sixth, respectively. Tennessee fifth, LSU sixth in the SEC standings. The top six get a bye. And this is a critical one for both sides. Tennessee going to number five, Texas A&M on Sunday. And LSU closes with a tough stretch as well.
You can see the speed by Maya Neal, keeping her eye on that one, making sure that Thomas doesn't get a piece of it.
Tennessee, the field has been slanted to our right-hand side. They've taken five shots here in the second half.
And LSU's standing up Buddy pretty well. They've got Lucy Parker man-marking her. And as Lucy steps for that ball, they've got another player, Richie Williams, dropping in behind her.
Well, almost worked to perfection with that defensive alignment, getting Bielsack involved, but her shot was blocked by Parker. Shaw making this run down the sideline. Gets one touch on. Taken down outside of the box, and it'll go for a corner kick rather than a foul. And Tennessee will take it on that far flag.
So if I'm the Tennessee coaching staff, recognizing that LSU is man-marking Bunny, you can see the man mark right there by Lucy Parker. A little bit of shirt tugging, a little bit of pushing. It's a good clean tackle by Parker.
Another opportunity here for the Vols. 11th corner. Cousins will serve it up. Cousins strikes it, looking for Shaw. Bielsack was making that run, but never made it to her as it's cleared out. You wonder how much longer you can go with Shaw here in this second half.
Well, again, Michael, as I said earlier in the game, just having her in there, I mean.
Vignola with a shot, and it beats Brockmeyer this time. A missile from Vignola, and Tennessee has tied it.
And that was just a phenomenal look from the outside for Vignola, and this is exactly what Tennessee needs to do in order to get that LSU defense honest. The shot from about 20 yards outside of the box, you can see it come across from Bielsack. Vignola able to take a touch and just fires it off her left foot, seeing the right side of the net. Brockmeyer caught on her heels, out of position, can't even make that save. And here we go, tied up, Tennessee.
Bunny Shaw comes off the field at this point as well. And Brian Penske has plenty to say to her after that. And you have to think that Shaw, although she didn't score, she certainly impacted those 13 minutes here in the second half that she was on the field, and Vignola gets her third goal of the season.
Well, I think that Coach Penske realizes that, you know, he's probably going to need to ask a little bit more of Bunny in this latter half of this game. LSU's not done yet. They're going to come back, packing a punch. They're a physical team. They're fiery. And I expect that this game's going to be a little bit chippy as it goes on.
The fans have really started to make a lot of noise as well here at Regal Soccer Stadium. Bielsack, who had the assist, flings this one towards the box, and Brockmeyer will pick it up. So Tennessee had been probing And this service from Bialzak and a great touch by Vignola.
Fantastic touch. Just gets that, you know, edge around LSU, able to find the back of the net on the right side. And it's, as I said all game long, you either are going to have to work from the outside in or take those shots from on, you know, 20, 18 yards out in order to keep LSU honest. The goals aren't going to come from within the box that easily.
So let's see how Tennessee functions without Shaw on the field now here in the second half. O'Keefe coming away with a ping-ponging ball. Now Gilroy making a run. She had some chances in the first half. Gilroy has runners in the middle. She gets to the end line, crosses it in, past a pair of players. Bialzak making the run, and another great opportunity for Tennessee. But things have opened up, and countering is LSU. Thomas, who scored the goal for LSU in the 10th minute, holding it up 2-on-5.
And that was, Erin Gilroy did a great job driving it down the right side of the field, slotting it back. That's something I've been wanting to see Tennessee do all night. And have had Tennessee had numbers in the box, that could have been converted. But, you know, LSU with the quick counterattack almost caught Tennessee by surprise. And if it weren't for, you know, Thomas having to slow it down because her teammates weren't up with her, that could have very easily been another goal for LSU. It's the quick counterattacks. Tennessee's going to have to watch that.
Parker again striding forward. It's been from the defenders that have started some of these breaks for LSU. Here comes Tennessee. No numbers in pink jerseys, at least for the time being, as Flynn will take it out towards the corner flag. Flynn with the ball on her feet, tries to cross this one in. Brockmeyer left-footed touch. She's on the ground, and LSU is able to clear it away for the time being. Tennessee coming out with a different fire here in the second half as Burdett takes it away from Richardson. Burdett will take a right-footed shot. Brockmeyer, a diving catch. And fortunate for LSU that she caught it and didn't redirect it because Flynn was to her right.
And Brockmeyer just getting a great read on it. Burdett with the spin away from Brockmeyer. Her timing on that was exceptional. Able to get both hands on it, preventing that rebound. As you mentioned, Megan Flynn was coming hard on that back post looking for a rebounded conversion.
So Tennessee has reset the game thanks to the goal by Vignola in the 58th minute. Vols are 7-0-1 here all time against LSU, but five of the last nine have gone to overtime in this series. Another tight one tonight.
Tennessee just trying to take control in terms of the pace. They like to slow it down, and then they like to accelerate. They like to have that change of pace in their attack. I think when they go offensively, they got to make sure they have numbers up. We saw in the last attack, they only had two. It was like 2v5. They got to make sure they're getting more pink jerseys forward into the attack.
You do feel like Tennessee has had a lot of possession here of late, and particularly here in the second half. Let's see how LSU responds and if they can find a way to get back on top. Foul whistled, and LSU will get a free kick. Both of these coaches mentioned that although we are getting down towards the end of the season in SEC tournament conversation, neither one really mentioned it to their teams. Coach Penske talked that he said, here's the standings, but nothing else. He said that the time would be wasted talking about the standings when they could be talking more technique and how the game needs to be played against LSU.
You want to know why, Michael? It's because when you got five SEC teams ranked in the top 25 right now, I mean, anything can happen. I mean, it's these last three, four games of the conference where, you know, it's just everybody's taking cheap shots at each other in terms of, you know, who's going to end up. You've got all sorts of upsets that happen towards the end of the seasons. You know, a lot of it because, you know, people are fighting to get into the tournament or there's injuries. I mean, we see Ole Miss, they're without their starting goalkeeper. You know, those types of elements, those missing pieces, that makes a huge difference in the results that come up with for the teams.
Yeah, plenty of things can still happen down the stretch as Bialzak will get a break and Franks will come in, and a couple fresh players for LSU as well, splitting a double team for the time being, but Neal hits it out of play. A little redshirt junior also on the track team. Second team All-American. There. Long throw comes into the box. Neal again has to play it. Tennessee clears. This is a lot of possession here for LSU as this seeking missile goes over the top of the trees and out of play. Marty Smith and Ryan McGee, a.k.a. Marty and McGee, the TV show, will be on the SEC Network tonight at 9 Eastern, 8 Central. You can never get enough of the M&M boys. Like everything else, you can see them live on the ESPN app as well from anywhere. Marty and McGee, fueled by Gatorade. So the ball scoring in the 58th minute. LSU getting one in the 10th. And Tennessee might have a lead if Bunny Shaw's penalty kick in the 47th minute isn't tapped by Brockmeyer after it glanced off of the post. LSU was able to clear it, but a 1-1 contest right now. 25 minutes to go here at Regal Soccer Stadium. LSU controlling some possession, but they give it away. One touch, and Gilroy, the benefactor of it. She's in behind the defense, into the box. Right-footed shot attempt goes wide. She had a defender on her back and looked like her balance just wasn't quite there and just pushed it wide.
And Gilroy's had several looks tonight, just unable to connect with the back of the net. She feels the pressure of Parker, and I think that was just enough to kind of, as you said, cause her to lose her balance, not able to get that clean shot off. Michael, in talking about both of these teams, and LSU, their next matchup is against number 8, South Carolina, and then number 25, Mississippi State. Tennessee will then turn around and take on number 5, Texas A&M. So both of these teams have big games coming up next.
And I think for both sides, if they can get 3 points out of tonight, that takes pressure off at the end of the season. Making this run is Riley O'Keefe along this sideline. She plays it into the box. It takes a ricochet, nearly a disaster for LSU. Gilroy was right in that area, but LSU was able to clear it. Vignola, who scored the goal for Tennessee, crosses this one. Takes one deflection towards the sideline.
Here we go.
LSU 46th in the RPI. Tennessee is 14th. So Tennessee, you feel like, is in really good shape for the NCAA tournament, but certainly want to play well here at the end of the season.
Well, absolutely, and especially because, you know, the SEC conference is such a tough one that, you know, going into the conference game, I mean, single elimination, you can be out first round, so seeding is everything. And both of these teams, LSU and Tennessee, the opponents that they have left on their schedule are pretty tough. So, yes, as you mentioned, 3 points tonight would definitely, you know, take that monkey off their back, take some of that pressure off their back.
There is the RPI. You see Texas A&M. That's Tennessee's next opponent, their third. As this cross comes into the box. Another miss hit. LSU's had some miscues here in this sequence. This shot comes on, flicked on, back post, and a couple opportunities, but Brockmeyer takes it off the foot of O'Keefe.
And that's what you get with the veteran inside the goal. So much confidence. She had two pink jerseys flying at her. Didn't even faze her. Kept her eye on the ball the entire time. You had O'Keefe right there. And you also had Claire Franks crashing in. But Brockmeyer able to come up big for LSU.
You definitely feel like through the first half of this second session that Tennessee has been the better side. They have the goal to tie it up at one apiece. And the balls continue to apply pressure. Vignola, great move to beat one defender. Getting towards the 18-yard box, using that left foot. Wants a strike here, takes it, and it's a deflection as she goes to the ground. Cousins now takes the shot on, and Brockmeyer uses the left paw to tip it over the crossbar.
And again, it's that shot from about 22 yards out. That's where Tennessee's getting their looks, and it's a little bit different for them. It's not necessarily what they're used to, but it's what they're going to have to do against this LSU team. Good, clean look, uncontested, and if there's one person that can put the heat and the power on that ball from far out, it's Katie Cousins.
Tennessee gets another corner. It'll be number 12 as O'Keefe hits it. Very short. Tennessee still with an opportunity as this swing by Burdette flares to the end line and goes out for a goal kick.
So when we talk about defending corner kicks, LSU is putting all their players inside of the box, and I'm surprised that Tennessee hasn't tried to play the short corner kick yet. I think that there's a real opportunity for them to take advantage of drawing some of those defenders out and finding some open space inside of the box if they look to play that short corner.
Coach Lee said the other day that defensively they have to clean things up on set-piece efforts. In the SEC, they do significantly more than that, and they have to be tougher in the box. Well, they've been just that here today. Making a run out of the back is Gunner, but she's dispossessed of the ball.
And this is where Tennessee has to be careful, because they are easily could be exposed on a quick counterattack, pushing Mackenzie Gunner, one of their center backs, forward.
O'Keefe comes outside. LSU has all of its players basically within 25 yards of net. This clearance will go out for Neal.
And Yanez for Tennessee, the goalkeeper, playing about 25 yards out from her box. Tennessee putting the urgency.
Flag goes up here. Vignola offsides.
And Michael, I can tell you that both of these teams want to take care of business within, you know, regulation time. I don't think either one of these teams want to have to play overtime and then turn around and take on top-ranked opponents 3 days later. So, you know, Tennessee's really pressing hard to see if they can wrap things up in regulation, and LSU, same for them.
70th minute, Tennessee and LSU deadlocked at one apiece. Thomas's goal in the 10th minute for LSU. Vignola's for Tennessee in the 58th minute, tied it. That's where we stand now with 20 minutes to go here at Regal Soccer Stadium. Gunner stepping forward, picking out Vignola along this near right sideline. Sliding it forward for O'Keefe. She plays it one time into the area, comes right back to her. Another opportunity into the area. And LSU is able to aid this along, but a miss hit. Gilroy chests it down, takes a right-footed shot. Another failed clearance by LSU, and now O'Keefe tracks it down.
And Vignola is wide open on top.
She's the target here. She gets to her left-hand side, splits a double team before it's cleared out towards midfield.
And LSU sitting in about on the 16. They are giving up about 4 or 5 yards from the 16 to about the 25. There's open space for Tennessee to take those shots.
That's where Vignola's goal came, just outside of the 18-yard box.
And I wouldn't be surprised if Coach Penske doesn't call in Bunny Shaw here for the last 15 minutes. You know, it's interesting, Michael, earlier in the game, when Bunny was in, LSU put Lucy Parker as a man marker on her. So anywhere that Bunny went, if she made a run to the left side, Lucy Parker was on her back. If she went to the right, Lucy Parker was on her back. And what that does for Tennessee, Lucy Parker's a center player. So if they draw her out, that means that space is then open to for Tennessee to attack into.
Eaton defended well in the box by O'Keefe, or Burdette rather, and it comes forward for Gilroy. Gilroy trying to win possession, but stepping back to get it is Alex Thomas.
And Thomas is one of those versatile players. And, you know, she plays in the back, she plays up top, and right now we see LSU's kind of put her on the backside, trying to help keep goals from getting scored against them.
It's a very young LSU group, so let's see how they handle this stretch run on the road for a team that has not come away with a win in an SEC road game since 2016. Vols defending, keeping it in play along that far sideline and conceding a throw. Richardson will come back in. She has 6 goals on the year for LSU, and she'll re-enter here with the final 17 and a half minutes showing on the regulation clock.
Richardson is so quick. That first step is extremely explosive, and I think you're going to see them look to her for some quick counterattacks playing on that far left side.
Long throw comes into the box, headed by Thompson across the face of net. Falls with 3 players there, unfortunately able to get it away for Tennessee. Now a right-footed effort from Thomas is stopped by Cousins, and then she slings it over towards the empty space on that far sideline. So after Tennessee had really applied a lot of pressure, now LSU doing the same. Neal is there for that header, angling it towards the corner and going out for a throw-in.
Time is ticking down. 16 minutes, roughly 41 seconds to go. Both of these teams are got to be very calculated in their opportunities.
Ball takes a couple deflections, and it's picked up by Chuchura. She takes a shot that's blocked by Neal. Now coming out towards the middle of the field. Right-footed attempt comes on, and Yanez plays it off of one hop. Here in the 79th minute of a 1-1 contest. Burdette will get it from Yanez. Now let's see if Tennessee can make something happen in this direction. Gilroy with the touch. It comes out towards the sideline. A lot of jostling going on, and Gilroy goes behind her back to give it to Burdette, and now O'Keefe. Great effort by Gilroy to set this up. O'Keefe looks for Vignola. A couple touches inside the area. Left-footed shot low and just wide.
And I believe that's going to be a corner kick. Riley O'Keefe splitting, finding Vignola, moving across the top of the box. Vignola just taking that touch horizontally across. Getting more on frame. Just a little touch, trying to slip it in there on that right side. Brockmeyer getting a touch, and here we go, Tennessee with a corner kick. They have to be very intentional about it.
Number 13 for the Vols as Bialzak returns for Tennessee. Her assist set up Vignola earlier. O'Keefe comes out. Katie Cousins to apply the service. The All-American hits it near post. Brockmeyer got a piece. It was headed by Tennessee. And will go out for a goal kick. Brockmeyer has had a fine night in net despite allowing the goal. She did save a PK in the 47th minute. And one of the best keepers to ever come through LSU's program. Restarts play. Final quarter of an hour here at Regal Soccer Stadium. Katie Cousins, third team All-American a year ago, and a member of the U-20 United States Women's National Team. One of several players on the Tennessee roster with international experience. LSU with several on their side as well. Now the field opens up again here for Tennessee.
I think Tennessee has to make sure they protect the ball. Can't afford to have any turnovers.
Like they nearly just had, that almost led to a 2-on-1 break. Shaw has tallied 20 minutes. Really do wonder if Penske would push anything here in the final 13 plus.
Well, a couple of things. You know, it's tough as a coaching staff.
This ball slides through the box, and Tennessee able to recover and get to it with Vignola, who clears it forward. Parker's setting it up, taking a shot. Yanez has to dive. I don't know if that was directly on frame, but she felt like she needed to get a right hand to it with a leaping effort and push it out of play and give up the first corner for LSU.
I think due to the spin, she wasn't quite sure if it was going to curve or drop in, so I think that hand on it was just for assurance to make sure there's no way that that was going to go in the back of the net.
It probably was on target at that point.
Tennessee needs to be careful because on top of the box is two of LSU's top goal scorers.
Sunday, it's a top 20 showdown in the SEC at 5 Eastern. It's number 18 Tennessee visiting College Station to take on number 5 Texas A&M. It's SEC Soccer on the SEC Network Game's also streaming live on the ESPN app. Will Tennessee have a win? Or will they have to settle for a tie or loss? Final 12 minutes of regulation here against LSU.
I think it's tough being, you know, coaches when you're always wrestling with playing time for various players. But, you know, in Bunny's situation, she's had a big game, 110 minutes, you know, helping her national team make history. And what you don't want to do as a coaching staff is make the decision to play her in a fatigue situation.
Gilroy to the top of the box and a shot that takes a deflection and goes out for a corner. Franks took an opportunity.
Here we go.
And Tennessee will get corner kick number 15.
And again, that opportunity came from on top of the 18. This is where Tennessee's seeing their opportunities wide open, favoring that right side of the goal at the moment.
Well, if you're Coach Penske, your problem can be solved if Tennessee can find a go-ahead goal.
That's right.
Cousins again will tee it up. She strikes it very low, and it comes right back to her and goes out of play for a throw.
And you got to think about the quality of serves. You know, you may not have that many opportunities, but you got to have the quality of service. And, you know, almost on cue, here's Bunny Shaw warming up. Tennessee trying to give her the last 10 minutes of the game, see if she can be the difference maker. But as I was saying, Michael, I mean, the last thing you want is for her to be playing with dead legs and come in here and end up getting hurt. And you would hate to see everything come to a roaring end, not only for Tennessee and her career here, but, you know, for the impact that she's having on her national team.
Gunner has it for Tennessee as the Vols look for a go-ahead goal here in the final 10 minutes of regulation. A deflection springs forward Molly Thompson. Not a lot of numbers forward, but she's 1v1 on Neal for the time being. Thompson stepping over, getting to the left-hand side. Neal there with a slide tackle, winning the ball and hitting it out of play.
Let me just tell you, Maya Neal's 1v1 skills have improved so much from the first time they put her on defense. Thompson just coming at her, trying to fake her left, right, left. And Maya Neal, it's that first touch, that explosiveness about her, able to get all ball on the tackle. She's so quick in the back. And
LSU not done yet, getting the throw as this shot is on. Diving effort by Yanez, and it goes out for a corner kick after Chutura takes that shot.
Chutura just ripping that shot, looking for that left side of the post. Makes a quick little touch around Burdette. Yanez coming up with the save, and LSU at the corner.
Bayou Bengals will get another opportunity here on a corner, their second, and it'll be Chutura to take it. Serves it in near post, knotted to the ground, and then Cousins will clear it forward, but a white jersey there to answer to it. Another ball coming into the box. A defender for Tennessee goes down. Now a right-footed shot takes a deflection and goes out of play.
I believe that's Claire Franks. Looks like she kind of got hit, but she's up, so that's always a good thing.
There is Bunny Shaw. 20 minutes tonight. She was on the pitch when Tennessee scored the equalizer in the 58th minute. Vignola blasting one past Brockmeyer. Official stops the clock. And this will allow Franks to come out of the game, who, as you mentioned, got caught up right near the penalty spot. And O'Keefe will come in, and Frank's limping noticeably off towards the sideline.
You know, another player I haven't seen for Tennessee play that much is Marcano. Danielle Marcano, she's so fast, her explosiveness. I would think that would be a great 1-2 punch combination for Tennessee in this last 8 minutes. Marcano's speed along with Bunny Shaw's, you know, just sensibility, soccer IQ, physicality, I think that would be a great way to end the game.
The bomb of a corner kick is mishit by Shannon Cook, and the Vols will get a goal kick. And I think for both sides tonight, you look at the set pieces. Granted, LSU hasn't had a ton, and there's a lot to be desired between both of these sides handling things?
Let me tell you, when you get to the NCAA tournament, games are won and lost on your ability to convert corner kicks and set pieces. That's the difference between a good team and a great team. And this far into the season, you need to be able to have better conversions. When you've got 14 corner kicks like Tennessee has and not being able to convert one of those, that is an opportunity to train.
You saw Bunny Shaw is standing and prepared to re-enter this match.
If I'm Coach Lee, I'm telling my players, do not kick the ball out. Do not kick the ball out. Let's keep Bunny Shaw off the field as long as we possibly can.
7 minutes to go as this free kick is hit into the box. Cousins is there to win it at 5 feet even and head it towards the sideline.
You talk about a player who's consistent day in and day out, it's Katie Cousins. She's probably the most composed, relaxed player that there is on this field.
Another cross coming in, this one from Thomas. Cousins again. That defending, able to clear one away with an LSU player right in the six-yard area. We talked about Cousins needing to challenge herself defensively as Yanez has to leap up, and a good catch with players near her leaping legs. But Cousins does a good job defending initially, and Yanez, the final stop.
6 minutes to go. Not much left time left.
Five of the last nine meetings between these two programs have needed extra time. The regulation 90 was not enough. Yanez nearly a disaster there, but was somehow able to avoid.
And that's just an unnecessary risk, in my opinion. 5 minutes to go, 1-1 game. There's no need for her to take that kind of risk. I mean, when you've got that type of athleticism displayed by LSU's front runners, they're that close to you need to clear it first time.
Bunny Shaw is back in, and it's just ridiculous seeing her out here after 110 minutes last night on an international stage in Dallas. She arrived at 2 o'clock today in Knoxville. And she's out there for Tennessee trying to lead the Vols as she gets this touch on a defender and a good effort there by Richie Williams. But now O'Keefe serves one towards the back post, headed wide by Gilroy. 5 minutes to go in regulation. Tennessee 1, LSU 1. If you're just joining us, Shaw led Jamaica to the World Cup for the first time in the history of that country and the first Caribbean country to ever qualify for the World Cup. Jamaica winning 4-2 in PKs after a 2-2 draw in the run of play against Panama last night. Shaw had 19 goals in CONCACAF qualifying, leading every player in the world.
There's an LSU player down on the field. I believe that's Richardson.
Richardson is down and the official stopping play with 4:22 to go here in the second half. Ryan Penske appealing to the fourth official. He didn't think that play should be stopped. It certainly looked like Tennessee had something cooking.
Well, I can halfway agree with Coach Penske. I mean, unfortunate that LSU's player down, but the Tennessee was advantage. You know, they had the ball. They're getting ready to attack. They had advantage. So I can understand his frustration with the call, especially given that there's 4 minutes left, 0-0. Good to see Richardson on her feet, though.
You take a look at it. It's in the bottom left, right in the circle there. Looks like maybe she got stepped on by Burdett. You see Burdett lose her balance a little bit as well. And Richardson will have to come off the field here for the time being.
And this is big. Anytime you have a stoppage in play for for any amount of time, but especially when it's been such a hard-fought battle and it's 1-1, this is all about mentality. The first 5 minutes over any stoppage of play is critical. You've got to stay focused. I mean, this is when goals can be scored.
LSU will play with 10 for the time being. And Richardson is allowed back on the field after the game resets here in the 86th minute of a 1-1 contest. Gotten your money's worth if you came here tonight for this contest. 21st all-time meeting in a series that LSU has dominated. Or that Tennessee has dominated, rather. LSU has only won four times against Tennessee in the all-time series. Vignola. She scored Tennessee's goal in the 58th minute. She's charging forward for Tennessee. Vignola looked like she was going to take a shot on frame, but a slide tackle by Thomas clears it for the time being.
And I like Thomas's aggressiveness. She recognizes that Vignola has a very strong left foot, doesn't want to take any risks, makes that sliding tackle, denying Vignola with that opportunity.
Thomas scored the goal, and Coach Lee talked about her the other day. What they do is they play with her up front until they get the lead, and once they get the lead, she goes to the back. Very intelligent player. LSU now with an opportunity charging forward, but stepping to it defensively. Comes Tennessee in the opposite direction.
And again, you've got Mackenzie Gooner, who's the center back for Tennessee, charging forward. And it's her and Bunny Shaw, 2 versus 6. So Tennessee has to be able to attack it with a lot, much more pace. I mean, goodness, there's 2.5 minutes left. There has to be more urgency about them.
Tennessee trying to build something up in a 1-1 contest here in regulation. Bialzak's pass was deflected by Richardson. Now it comes out wide here for Cook. Cook, slow to start things up. A miss hit. Bialzak gives way to Richardson. 2:20 left in regulation of a 1-1 contest. Richardson sends it forward. It's taken away by the Vols, and now they can start things in the opposite direction. And another missed pass. But now Cousins is able to free things up to this near sideline.
Tennessee's trying to thread passes right now when they have the opportunity just to play simple.
Shaw uses a ball to come forward. One touch just off the toes of Bialzak, and then Parker clears it towards the sideline. French using some physicality to win possession back. 100 seconds left in regulation. Gilroy outside. Gilroy able to evade a defender, gets into the box. Gilroy puts one for Shaw. It takes a skip off of an LSU defender and goes out for a corner kick, and it'll be number 16 for Tennessee.
Can this be the corner kick that Tennessee converts on?
This is number 16. Six shots on goal apiece.
I still think Tennessee should at least put a player out there as if they were going to do a short play. Draw one more LSU player out of the box, freeing up a little bit more space. You can see the numbers back that they have.
Cousins sends it in, and it's cleared away. And now LSU, they'll try to use their speed to come in the opposite direction. Richardson, there are two defenders back in Gooner and Neal. Tennessee trying to get its shape. Richardson goes out wide. Neal there with a slide tackle. Not only does she win the ball, but she gets her team a throw in the final 38 of regulation. Neal will clear it forward. Bialzak will chest it to the ground. Half minute to go in regulation of a 1-1 contest. And now they say that the ball hit Bialzak's hand with 20 seconds left. LSU with a set piece. 15 ticks remaining. Everybody coming forward.
Yeah, and Yanez needs to get on her line because LSU does a great job of lofting those balls up. The easiest way to defend those high lobbing balls is to be on your line so that it doesn't drop in behind her.
It'll be Chutura to take this one. 5 seconds left. It almost needs to be a one-time touch. as the clock does stop here momentarily. 5 seconds left of a 1-1 contest. Chutura to take it. Things setting up in the box. Brockmeyer's all the way out to midfield. And now the official having to clear off some pushing and shoving in the box. Looks like Neal and Cooker getting into it. Now the whistle is blown. Chutura hits it. Clock starts. Back post goes over everybody's head. That's how regulation comes to a close. Kind of in a fitting manner. Set pieces have really been struggles for each side, and anticlimactic ending to regulation.
Well, I think LSU's done a great job of hanging in there. They've been able to defend against Tennessee's top players, denying them any opportunities. They've had very minimal chances. Although LSU's given up a lot of corner kicks, Tennessee hasn't proven themselves to be dangerous over the ball when it comes to corners tonight.
Plenty of corner kicks for Tennessee. You see 16 corners, Tennessee 21 shots, but only six of those have been on frame. Each keeper with five saves so far. Alex Thomas a goal in the 10th minute, Vignola in the 58th. And now if you're Coach Penske, you've been able to have Bunny Shaw out there for 26 minutes. How much longer can you possibly continue to have her on the field?
Well, I think, again, it's like you got to think about your strategy. When you put Bunny Shaw in there, you're drawing out Lucy Parker, their other center backs. They're man-marking Bunny. So anytime she makes a run left or right, that's creating space for one of the Tennessee forwards to attack into. However, you don't want to tap out her legs and run the risk of injury due to fatigue. So, you know, it's a tough call. I do think that they have the depth. Tennessee's posted goals this year from 13 different players. Why not give Danielle Marcano an opportunity? Why not put Solaire Jordan back in there? You know, Amy Thompson, there's several players that Tennessee could go to their bench for.
1-1 at the end of regulation. This is now the sixth time in the last 10 meetings these two teams have needed overtime. Tennessee has won three times. LSU has won three times. And it's been a draw on three occasions, albeit one of those draws was a Tennessee win in penalties, 4-2 in the SEC tournament in 2008. We'll have at least one 10-minute session. Overtime coming up here in a moment of a 1-1 contest.
Alex Thomas just starting it off for LSU. So shifty, sliding the ball, guaranteeing a goal for LSU. And then you have Bunny Shaw, and it's Brockmeyer getting a hand on it, denying Tennessee any opportunity. And then the tie for Tennessee right here is Mary Alice Vignola. It's the pass from Bialzak. Vignola finding the outside of the net from 18 yards out. That brings us to 1-1.
Overtime rules to refresh your memory. Two 10-minute periods. It is a sudden victory, a golden goal situation. If a team scores, that's it. No re-entry in the first or second overtime periods, four substitutions. If we're still tied at the end of 110 minutes, it is a tie. And looking out onto the field right now, Tennessee will not have Bunny Shaw out on the field for this overtime session. You see the records. Tennessee has drawn twice. LSU on the other side has drawn once and lost twice this season. LSU on the other side needed two overtimes at Arkansas in its last road contest, losing 2-1 to the Razorbacks. Tennessee on the other side, their last game was double overtime, and they were unable to find a goal against Georgia. So let's see how this plays out. And Torrey, Tennessee in that second half seemed like they controlled possession, had better opportunities, but again, set pieces, they weren't able to really apply too much pressure on Brockmeyer.
That's exactly right. I mean, I really think that Tennessee stepped up the tempo of the game. I think they played with a little bit more urgency, acted as if they wanted to take control. Unfortunately, they haven't really had too many opportunities in front of the net, but You know, what's tough about overtime is that every second counts because it is golden goal. First team to score, and that's it. So you can't afford to take a 10-second timeout. The 1 second that you pause to catch your breath could be the moment that the other team is scoring on you. So both teams are going to have to capitalize on their opportunities quick and early and make sure that they stay focused for the entirety of this overtime period.
LSU has never won here in Knoxville. Tennessee trying to keep it at that. There's only been one draw here all time in Knoxville. That came back in 2010. LSU equalized in the 88th minute with under 3 minutes to go. They equalized back in 2010. So does Tennessee keep true to script and find a game winner here in overtime? Or is it LSU that comes away with one?
And in overtime periods, I mean, you don't ever want to give up corner kicks, but especially during overtimes, because the precision, you know, just the intention of trying to capitalize on those moments is intensified.
Ren French has to settle this ball down and play it back in the other direction. Gilroy trying to gain position. Instead, it flings back for Flynn. Flynn with two defenders on her, splits one, trying to get past a second, and it is Lucy Parker hitting it out of play.
And I have to give hats off to Lucy Parker. She's playing exceptional defense. She's reading that Megan Flynn and whoever she's posting up on Erin Gilroy. She's starting off centered, and then she's cheating to the left or right and able to win those balls.
Gilroy going for the back post, and Brockmeyer is there. Looked like Bignola was making that run to the back post and what seemed to be a fairly harmless ball nearly was a game winner for Tennessee.
And I believe that was Molly Thompson that was rounding out the back post, just giving LSU the extra defense that they needed to cover that back post Bignola. And it was Thompson that was able to hold off Bignola from being able to connect on that.
Bignola sends it across the field and Tennessee maintains possession here with French. French flings it forward, but headed right back in that direction. Cousins with a good initial touch. Now dribbling to the top of the box. Right-footed shot that was dipping into the chest of Brockmeyer. I like what you're seeing here from Tennessee in the opening moments of the first overtime session. Cousins will settle this one down as, again, the ball finds her feet. Flynn sends this one along. Gilroy making the run. Parker there in defense, and Parker concedes a corner, and here's number 17 now for Tennessee.
This is where Tennessee needs to take their time. Gilroy, you can see, just kind of taking her time, allowing her teammates to set up, and finally, Vignola coming over, and look, she's bringing two defenders with her. And that alone is creating more open opportunities inside of the box.
And they do go short, just like you asked, but defended well by Richardson. Gilroy quickly takes the throw, however. Gunner surveys, takes a seeking shot on, and it goes wide.
I like that look, though, from Tennessee. Even though they didn't have success on it, you can see what it does. When they play that short corner, it draws two LSU defenders out. That's two less people that are inside that six-yard box. That gives you a little bit more space to work with.
Tennessee promptly gets the ball back after Brockmeyer's low goal kick. Bignola racing after it, and it goes out of play, and Tennessee gets the throw. Falls 15 shots after the break. But Tennessee still looking for that game winner now in the 105th minute here at Regal Soccer Stadium. Cousins sends it over the right-hand side, now looking for Gilroy. It's headed right back towards Cousins. Cousins a couple touches to her right. Gets it out wide. Good bit of defending, and the ball will go out of play for a throw-in for LSU.
And that ball over the top is just not working for Tennessee. They keep trying to chip it or slide it over the top right through the middle. And, you know, personally, I think that's too easy to defend. It's very easy to read. You know where they're going to go with it. So defensively, that's not really a challenge. You just stand up your player and you make sure they're not able to turn on you. What's tough to defend is when the ball comes out wide, because now the defender's in a position where they have to choose. Do I step? Do I go out and I defend that cross coming in? Or do I stay at home? And I think Tennessee has to do more of drawing LSU's players out, creating those passing channels to work into.
LSU's a very young group. As many as 8 underclassmen have been on the field at the same time this season. 6 of their top 8 scorers are underclassmen. Let's see if Tennessee's experience provides the advantage here in overtime. Vols controlling possession here halfway through the first session. Cross comes in, past Flynn, and comes out wide. And LSU trying to track back the other way now and get their first opportunities here of the extra session. Tennessee able to handle the initial bit of defending, but a flick ball comes for Eaton, who crosses it right to the middle of the field and promptly comes back out. O'Keefe, left-footed ball looking for Gilroy, but pops into the chest of Alexander. Alexander had the run that set up Thomas's goal in the 10th minute. She gives way to French. O'Keefe plays it out of bounds, and it'll go for a throw for LSU as Tennessee was trying to steal one away. 107th minute of a 1-1 contest. Petritus throw it in. Petrie lobs it. Neal goes over her head on a pass intended for Eaton, and now Cousins will get towards the corner flag and just sling it over towards French. Out of the middle of the field, O'Keefe. Gilroy will hold it up, get over her right shoulder, keep it along the line. It stays in play, but Alexander takes it away from her. Out of the middle of the field, it goes for Newton. Now the far left sideline, LSU with their first sustained possession here of overtime.
And look how quickly the Tigers are moving it. They started on the right side, they worked the ball around to the left, and now they're attacking back down the right side. Just that shift, that move, going from one side to the other is what causes confusion with back lines.
Petrie's cross is blocked, and then she gets taken down, and it goes out of play. It'll be a Tennessee throw, despite bodies falling to the ground.
Again, this is where you just really have to stay dialed in with your focus. You can't afford to take a 10-second break, because that's when your opponent's going to try to take advantage of you.
Now Vignola coming back the other way. Vignola taken off the ball nicely by Newton, but Vignola tracks back to get it. Final 2 minutes of this initial extra session. If we need it, we'll go to a second 10-minute sequence. Tennessee quickly takes the throw. Vignola from the nearly the spot where she scored the equalizer has one deflect off of a teammate and go out of play for a goal kick with 1:50 left. Tennessee 23 shots, 7 on frame. LSU 13 shots, 6 on target. Flynn will pick up the ball, fling it forward. Now it comes back over towards this sideline. Petrie has it, splits a pair of Tennessee defenders. Now Neal tracking back, hits one high into the air over her head. French heads it, and a foul is whistled. And Tennessee will get a chance here in the final 70 ticks of the first overtime session. Neal takes it fairly quickly, looking for Gilroy, and a touch comes out towards the sideline. Good play by Parker. She gets it back in combination. And now Parker will play it to the middle of the field. Final 3/4 of a minute. Here with the first overtime session. Long ball played for it, hustling after it is Eaton on that far sideline. She gets to it, keeps it in play, and Tennessee has to just aid it along in the final half minute. of this opening overtime period.
And this is dangerous because LSU has the long throw. Chrissy Petrie is able to sling that ball in. Pretty good farce. So they, you know, LSU sometimes will play this as a corner. She can sling that ball in almost close to the 6-yard box. So this could be a very dangerous attack.
Well, it's interesting, too. They use a substitution. And by doing so, they basically eliminate any time in which they would have a chance to use that long throw. So they use the sub, bring in Kathy, and they don't take advantage of that opportunity to have the ball in that area. So at the end of the initial 10-minute period, 100 minutes in the books, it is still 1-1, and we'll need 10 more minutes at least here in Knoxville. And let's see how these two teams answer coming out of this break. And Tori, you look at this one between these two sides, some missed opportunities for each team in terms of set pieces. But if you're LSU, you feel pretty good about where you're at right now as we welcome you up here to the broadcast booth. And Tennessee, 24 shots, a lot in the second half. How do they find a goal here in the second half?
Well, you know, you got to look a little bit further into that stat. So they have 24 shots, but how many of those are actually on goal? And that's the key to tonight. Tennessee hasn't had very many clean looks. Erin Gilroy's had the ball. She's, you know, dribbled down the field several times, but you know, in the attack, Tennessee really hasn't had the numbers forward that we're used to seeing. LSU, on the other hand, very explosive, extremely athletic, and it's the quick counterattacks is where they've seen the success. So I think, you know, for LSU, you're going to have to continue to have those counterattacks, and they have to come quickly.
10 minutes left. I'm sure neither of these coaches thinking too much about how this will stack up in SEC play. But Tennessee 5th, LSU 6th, with that tough slate left to go, one of these two teams would love to come away with 3 points.
Oh, it'd be huge. You know, I think even if they tie, they come away, you know, with 1 point. So, but, you know, 3 points would be big for them, especially looking at who they take on afterwards. And playing 120 minutes and then turn around and have to take on South Carolina or some of these other teams that they're getting ready to face is going to be tough for them. So, if to close it out and get a victory tonight would be big for either side.
Tennessee at fifth-ranked Texas A&M on Sunday. They close it out at home against Missouri. LSU, eighth-ranked South Carolina, waits in Baton Rouge on Sunday. Then they go to Starkville to take on 25th-ranked Mississippi State on next Thursday to wrap up regular season play.
So, Michael, to point out, you know, once you make your substitutions, they're not allowed to re-enter. So Tennessee right now has made the decision to put Bunny Shaw back on the field to see if they can get a little bit more of a punch up there. And I think this is smart because, as I said, Lucy Parker typically is man-marking her. And so if Bunny slides out to the left or right, she's creating that space in and behind. I think Tennessee's got to be more intentional about finding feet in those channels.
So they bring Bunny Shaw back out here for the second overtime period. And the storybook seems to be maybe a little too perfect if she's the one that gets the game winner. But that is what Coach Penske is banking on, at least for her to play a big role in this final 10-minute sequence.
And I know Coach Lee has a lot of confidence and Thomas as a defender in the back, but I think that they had a lot of opportunities up top with Thomas and Richardson. I mean, the two of them up top, their explosive touch, just their athleticism, their fierceness, the physicality, I think that would be a good combination as well.
The all-Zach for O'Keefe, she takes a shot and slides through the 18-yard box, and Brockmeyer there to squat down and pick it up.
And it's a good strategy for LSU. They understand that Tennessee's got the talent and the skill. So they're giving Tennessee those outside shots because they have confidence in Brockmeyer's ability to come up with it.
Dangerous ball played back as Richardson was hunkering down, but Yanez will give up a throw-in on that far sideline. 1 minute gone by here in the second overtime period. Tennessee 17 corners in this one. Overall, a fairly clean game. No bookings for either side. As this will go out for a goal kick here for the Vols. Tennessee has been ranked for 19 straight weeks, but things don't get any easier after this one. Going to fifth-ranked Texas A&M. on Sunday. So they'd love to come out of here with 3 points. And certainly for LSU, they'd like the same. Ball bouncing in the air. Chuturu will send it backwards. Ritchie. Shaw was providing all sorts of pressure, but LSU able to evade that. Here's Richardson again. She swings it across the field. And here come the Bayou Bengals. Back right to left. 2 minutes gone by in the second overtime. A double-teaming effort, and Bialzak wins possession, trying to use her body. She goes to the ground. No foul. Clean win for LSU. And now Cousins comes away with another ball. She's been in the right spot several times here late. Shaw holding it up, all on her feet, spinning away from Parker, trying to get past another defender. Shaw has opened things up. She picks out Bialzak to the left-hand side. Bialzak into the box, left-footed shot, pass Brockmeyer. It goes wide. Brockmeyer gets a piece, and it's a corner kick again for Tennessee.
And this is where I want to scream at Aaron Gilroy. Back post run, near far slot. So Bunny Shaw dribbling straight at LSU's center back, makes that sliding ball on the backside, sees Anna Bialzak, who looks for that far side, and you can see Gilroy, if she just had an explosiveness, just a little bit extra stride, makes you wonder, could she have gotten there?
McKee's initial corner kick is hit out of play, and Tennessee gets another one. Let's see if a service this time from Tennessee.
And again, the short option is there.
O'Keefe strikes it. An outswinger. Back post, Shaw in the area, but it goes over her head. Vignola tracks it down. Vignola sends it right back in. Brockmeyer this time steps off of her line, bumps in to Gilroy, and picks up the ball.
Make no mistakes about it. Coach Lee and his team would love to walk out of here with a big victory. But at the same time, Michael, a tie against Tennessee. They're ranked number 18. You know, this will be huge for them in terms of RPI. They have one that's 46, whereas Tennessee's ranked 14th. So, you know, when you're talking about postseason play, this is still, would still be good for them.
Great run by Vignola, but eventually her touch is too much, goes out of play. So with those two corner kicks, Tennessee now with 19 corners. That is a Tennessee record. For Tennessee, a program record here today. And you know that if Tennessee comes out of here with a tie, maybe even if they win, Coach Brian Penske is going to talk a lot about the corners and the lack of ability to capitalize on those chances. Richardson slides it over to the right-hand side. Tennessee trying to get back defensively, and Gunner is able to deflect a shot attempt.
And it's a good thing Gunner was able to take those steps to the outside, because Eaton was running uncontested on the right side of the field. She's got a solid shot. But fortunately for Tennessee, they were able to deny her a clean look.
105th minute. And a fifth corner for LSU. Shaw is in there to head it out of harm's way for the time being. Richardson swings one back in. Cleared away by Tennessee as Neal swings it forward but gives possession back to Richie Williams. Another opportunity here for LSU. Ball swings into the box. Bodies go to the ground. Bialzak clears it away. Tennessee frenetically trying to get it out as this shot goes over the top of the bar. By Newton.
And Newton looks as if she's got a little bit of a limp at the moment. Slow to recover. But man, what a shot she took.
Tennessee right now just cannot maintain possession after the goal kick. They give it back away. But Richardson gives it back. Final 4:15 of this one. Tennessee has never lost here at home to LSU. Falls with possession. Vignola, she scored the equalizer in the 58th minute. She's splitting a couple defenders. Vignola goes to the right-hand side. Shaw is offsides. And she did not think that she was. It wasn't the greatest pass, but you would have liked to have seen what Shaw could have done.
She has such a gracefulness about her. I mean, just kind of hanging out, and then all of a sudden just takes off chasing that ball down. Makes you wonder what she could have done with it if she wasn't called back.
Final 3.5 minutes of this one. Will a winner be crowned here in Knoxville, or will these two teams have to settle for a draw? LSU more attacking here in the second overtime period than they were in that opening 10-minute session. Richardson the intended target, but too much weight on that pass. Yanez picks it up as we wind into the 108th minute of a 1-1 contest. Yanez picks out Vignola. Vignola goes behind her back, left to right, charging forward. Finds Shaw on the left-hand side. Shaw will attract all sorts of attention. Goes behind her back, right to left. Good pace to get into the box. She's taken down. No penalty. Instead, it will be a corner kick. Shaw didn't seem to disagree too vehemently.
You can see she takes that cut back. And Lucy Parker, again, clean tackle. You can see on the replay, she got all ball.
Cousins with the service. Sends it in, middle of the area. Shaw with the header! She puts it in! The storybook ending for the Jamaican International wins it for Tennessee!
And that's what a player like Bunny Shaw can do for your team. Stands 5'11", put her inside of the box, 2 minutes to go in overtime. She finds a way to finish the game off. She's the it factor for this team, lifting them over LSU, giving Tennessee those 3 extra points that they need moving forward.
You've got to be kidding me. 34 minutes tonight after she led Jamaica to its first ever World Cup qualification.
And it starts with Katie Cousins. Excellent service. You can see the spin on it. Hangs it high enough. Allows Bunny to use those extra inches over her opponent to get a clean, solid head on it. Just hammering it straight back to the center. Brockmeyer overcommitted. Comes out. Bunny able to put it in the back of the net, and that's it.
She's probably never been happier to lay down in her life with that celebration. Not only is it her 8th goal now in 8 Tennessee matches, that's her 5th game winner this season for Tennessee. She plays 144 minutes in about a 26-hour period, and she wins it for Tennessee. The game changer that is Bunny Shaw has Tennessee on the right side of the scoreboard with a victory over LSU. So for Tori Beeler Watson, I'm Michael Watrang saying so long from Knoxville, where the final score is Tennessee 2, LSU 1. The Vols will be back here on Thursday, October 25th, to take on Missouri. To watch all of these games, log on to WatchESPN.com or download the Watch ESPN app.